Dorsey's time, we're going to move the transportation item number 4 to the top.
And I'm not really sure what this.
I know it because I just made it up.
Okay, well, there we go.
Yeah, I made it up.
I love being this.
Oh, Lord, tell us
about
it.
Yeah.
Tell us about it.
We're done already here.
Yeah.
Is it? We're done. Yeah. No. I think it has to do with how are we going to eat the rhinoceros?
It is. It is. I had a meeting completely different with Mr. Bond last week, and part of it that came forward to me is the vast amount of transportation projects the city of Port Orchard has. And right now, most of the funding available to us is for growth. It's for taking care of traffic, the movement of traffic, and it doesn't do anything for the preservation of our streets. And we can look at and get help for Sedgwick and regional money probably for Bethel and maybe Pottery Sydney. But we have neighborhoods that are in need of some work on their streets. And we have a pavement management system that we paid for a couple of years ago that outlines what streets needs what work. So the reason I put this on the agenda is I just wanted to start a conversation, and this is the committee I chair, so this is where I was going to start it.
So where we at the last budget process, we do have the pavement management system that prioritizes our streets, and they aren't necessarily with that pavement management system. It used sonar, I believe it was, Mark, and it looked not just at the Alligator Street, because the Alligator Street might not be the best street to put our resources into, because it looked at the subgrade. Because
right.
If we've got a street that
sinkhole
poor subgrade.
Poor subgrade, that's a bigger project than just doing an overlay. And so that tool helped us with that. And then as part of our budget process, I drove around, because we also have a ADA transition plan where we have to put a certain number of dollars every year to be compliant with this transition plan into sidewalks. And so we had, and then the other piece of this elephant is then you start paving and you start fixing sidewalks, and sidewalks make dams on the roadway that this now your ditch doesn't work and you need stormwater improvements.
It's a huge conversation.
So it's multifaceted. So I brought those lists forward of trying to marry those three together with the last budget process. Unfortunately, none of those projects made the budget because of Tremont. Every one of our transfers. So as part of our mid-biennial review, we have a prioritized list that we need to fund and we need to put dollars into it.
What my bringing this forward is we have a utility committee and we have an economic development committee, we have a land use committee, we have a finance committee. We don't have any group that focuses on transportation.
Yeah, it used to be when I first came here, we used to have a street committee. That's
right.
Now land use.
Right. So my question, and basically the dialogue I just kind of wanted to start, is do we want to make even an ad hoc committee of the council? Because money's the issue on all of this, money and time. And it could be that we want to do something as elaborate or as all-encompassing as Tacoma did, and that is to put a bond package out to our citizens and say, these are all the projects we can do, this is what it's going to cost, and do you want to pay for it? Or we can have a conversation and say, do we want to increase our tab fees if Tim Iman's initiative does not pass, and that will give us more revenue, or do we want to stay the course? But to me, it's a bigger discussion, and I was just bringing it forward to see where that conversation may start. And it may start just a work study, or it could start in land use, or it could be an ad hoc committee. committee. I just don't want to lose it. And we've been so focused on Tremont, and we all know that the pedestrian path is our next major transportation. And we know that people want something done with Bethel. And we know our growth is on the west side of town. But I'm here to tell you, Farragut's not a good street. Neither is Perry, neither is Tracy, neither is Goldenrod, neither is Flower. You know, so those neighborhoods are not going to have development that will pay for transportation upgrades. So I just want us to have a plan. I just want us to have a conversation.
Well, I can tell you where we're at right now. In public works in general, we're upside down.
Correct, I know.
We're wrapping up Tremont. Bay Street is the next big thing. Bethel's kind of simmering because we have the conceptual plan and really no way to kind of move that forward yet. Utilities are a major push for the next
right.
2 years for the city,
right.
kind of dealing with these delayed, deferred maintenance type tasks. So those are, you know, just from a staffing standpoint. So we've got to get, obviously, Well 9, Well 12, McCormick, Well 11, Pump Station 1 and 2, Green Pump Station.
Right.
We've got a large body of work there. Transportation-wise, we are very close to getting a surveyor on board as an on-call unit surveyor. So that we're going to be designing at the end of this year, we're going to get Ian going on designing a couple of in-house projects. It'll be the first time the city's ever done that. We'll be designing pottery from Sunset to, I think we're going all the way to Berry Lake as a potential, I mean, as a survey strip and looking at that.
But the two projects we said we were going to do one and two was Sydney Road from
Sedgwick south.
Headed south, and the other one was Lippert, and then farther down that list is that project you were referring to as Sunset. But the challenge with that is it's not the other two are just grind outs. We might have to replace a ramp or two. The one on the rest the remainder of pottery required stormwater improvements. We have a water line that we need to upgrade in there because if we put the sidewalk on top of it, then we tear it out later.
There was just conversation about maybe putting pottery between Lippert and 16 on the
diet. We were discussing a grant opportunity, and then we got some extra money out of Tremont that prevents us from having an application this next cycle. So that's 2 years out that we could apply for a grant, and that's to put Cedar Heights, you know, new wider bicycle paths, and it's worth four lanes there, and then connect the rest of the sidewalk down there at Sunset towards, so we have sidewalks basically from schools that we can go from school.
My point of bringing this forward wasn't to necessarily discuss the details
mm-hmm.
of the projects, but just get an understanding of how the council and the city may want to move this forward in determining funding sources, determining priorities. Because I think, you know, if we're talking, I think Sydney, south of Lippert, is in desperate need of something.
It certainly is. But yeah. It also involves a $5 million stormwater project.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I mean, there is so much, but.
Yeah, there's preservation.
Right.
I mean, a big part of what the city is going to have to tackle is the complete street. And we may end up marrying with the Well 13 project. There's going to be so many streets between Bethel, Sedgwick, and Maple, up, you know, through
right.
like that. A lot of those streets are going to get ripped up.
It's something.
With, we're
but
going to
anyway,
be
my point was to bring it forward mm-hmm. for to
your,
figure out.
Your ad hoc committee is not a bad idea. It might be just. A large chunk too of our next retreat is dedicated to street funding and whether we want to bring up, you know, go to the voters, and compile a list of significant projects and go to the voters.
Right, because I don't think we would have success if we weren't very definitive and give much as the state does in order to pass the gas tax. They have to give every area a little bit in order to get a buy-in, you know, from the from the legislature, and we would probably need to do. So anyway, I was just putting that out as something that I think needs our attention. And we've got that pavement management system, and it's getting dusty.
Well, no, we're using it.
You're using it.
Yeah, we're using it. But you gotta remember, there's three main categories that we deal with. We're doing our main transportation capital projects, like
right.
Tremont, Bethel, Bay Street. Then we have, well, we fall strictly into preservation,
right.
Whether those are mill and fills, or I know I had an inquiry from a council member about 6 months ago about, do we want to start doing chip seal and the benefits of chip seal? Well, problem with chip seals, you have to do it every, once you start,
you do it every
5 years or 3 years. And then there's the bigger issue we have, which is complete streets. Really, because a lot of the old streets that are chip seal, once we get into it and we have these separate issues, we're looking at old AC water mains or cast iron water mains. So now we're replacing the water main. Now we're saying, well, we're going to get in here, we need to do sewer while we're at it. Then, oh, as the mayor said, now we've got to do curb gutter and sidewalk because we're required to do ADA. Next thing you know, now you've got catch basins and collection conveyance, and then you have to find. So we're looking at a property that's at the very end of Sherman as being a major regional stormwater facility for the entire Sydney improvements. So we have to figure out
right.
from a drainer. So now it just becomes a complete.
Right, no, and I understand that. And that's why I was just throwing it out to let you know it's top of mind awareness for me. And
right.
how do we want to move
but forward? We are using both the ADA plan. I know that Ian, he created a spreadsheet off of the ADA matrix. It's been really beneficial. We've been using it. And then we've also been, he did the same thing with the pavement management system. So we've taken those base documents and we're actually utilizing them in a better way. So.
But anyway, I would invite us to think about an ad hoc committee or something in the retreat. Would you like to speak to it or offer any ideas?
Not right now. I was going to be anecdotal and just say, this past week when I've been talking to people in our neck of the woods west of 16, all I heard was, hey, when can we get some more roundabouts? They've just been pleased as punches.
That's probably our next major street project.
Right.
Is the Anderson Hill
Road. And I told people that, and they're like, tomorrow? I'm like, no, not quite.
That's probably a couple years out.
Bethel's going to be five. Yeah. I don't know if people know that, if you've seen our conceptual plan, but Bethel has
Everybody's getting it, but they've been very appreciative of Tremont opening.
And that, and again, it goes, it's different than what I'm talking about, because those major corridors, you know, everybody appreciates, but we have neighborhoods that.
But from an economic development standpoint, those three corridors, the Tremont,
correct.
The Bethel,
right.
and then the Sedgwick corridor, the,
right.
well, and then Sydney,
right.
between, you know, that's our box.
Right.
And so economic focus,
right.
but we have a fair amount of, you know, commercial potential
right.
to build some of that.
Right.
So on a related note, I had a conversation with somebody on Friday. Apparently, PSRC, and I believe Councilmember Ashby, you're on this committee, is writing new criteria for how countywide and regional funds are going to be allocated. And so they're looking at how that money is going to be dispersed going forward. And it sounds to me like there's an opportunity to sort of start making alliances and you know, there's two different factions in terms of how this debate is going, and we want to make sure that we benefit out, you know, in this process.
Right, it's the Project Selection Task Force, and we start, our first meeting is this Thursday, and then we meet monthly until December, I believe. And a lot of things happen there, but there is a preservation part that's pulled out, X number, a certain percentage that's regionally, and then that filters down to the countywides.
Right. It's mainly going into chip seal programs.
Yeah. So anyway, yes.
So I think really realistically, we need to wait till to see what how the dust, but we've got a mid-biennial review and whether or not we've got money in 2020 to fund the two projects that we have identified, which are street projects, you know,
right.
local streets, not major, they're overlays. And people will know that in probably the next 90 days. The IMIN initiative will know how that pans out and what tools we have left in our toolbox.
Right.
And then from there, I would say, you know, right after the first year, we're going to reassign the council, reassigns committees. Maybe one of the committees needs to be tweaked. Maybe it's just a work study item that's for your guys'.
I would just like it to keep it in front of us, because it's so easy to, the pie is this big and it's really easy for things to get lost. So that was all that was, is just how can we keep it on top of our mind and how can we move things forward. And then I know Mr. Dorsey has limited time, Commissioner Strackeljohn has limited time, so we will go to the community center discussion.
Can I ask one quick question for Mark? So the preservation money that comes from PSRC, is there any other way the city can use that other than chip seal preservation?
Well,
is there other ways of preservation?
Yes.
Spend that money so it doesn't create more work for the city?
Well, we can use it for preservation. It can be overlays. I'm just saying.
So it's not necessarily just chip seal?
No, for the most part. The people that have been using it, the county takes a big chunk of it. For their preservation, because they do a lot of chip seal. Bainbridge does a lot. Yeah, and Bainbridge is a very rural city. I mean, rural city, because the island became a city. So they do a lot of it. Bremerton is doing some experimentation, but it doesn't have to be chip seal.
Okay, that's my question.
Thanks, Mark.
Okay, so I passed out two documents, and these have both been works in progress. Matter of fact, Nick and I and Sharon spent a good fair amount of time Friday afternoon. So this is our latest edits, and they're still. And I'm by the end of this week, I intend to get these documents back to the PFD's attorney. So if we started with this one, it's this one here. It's his first draft on it. That is the PFD's ILA that they've sent to all of the top three projects. And there's a similar document that the racetrack already has. And their typical ILA, and it's where we've tweaked this, only funds specific tasks. And what I've spoke to at the last PFD meeting, and it seemed to be well received, was we want something besides just a feasibility study. We want a commitment to the whole thing that is going to take multiple years, but we've got the top project, and we want a commitment for full funding of our project. And the PFD board seemed receptive of that, and they said we need the ILA, and we need the what we were referring to at that time as a scope of work agreement, and we've since relabeled this. So you've seen this first. I don't want to go through this document. You could, if you want to look at the highlighted, or the red lines are really the areas that we changed this document. If you maybe ask questions. So the total ask of the PFD is $12 million. And when we get to the other document, you'll see how that $12 million is broken down.
Isn't that the total that they have to give out?
They have about 15 if they bond it, and I'll get to that in a moment. And they could have upwards to 40 million if they pledge cash flow. And that's the alternative I'm trying to present to them, is how they could just pledge cash flow and let the individual projects borrow their own money. Correct.
It'd be sort of like a reimbursement.
Yeah, they have a sales, a sliver of the sales tax.
Right.
And they get it in monthly installments from the state, and then they could divvy that that cash flow out.
Everybody would do their own bond.
Because their bond rate is double what ours or the county's would be.
Right. Almost makes common sense.
I know this is a lot of reading, but I'll just let you read through it and ask questions.
What is the timeline, Mayor, for?
That's in the next document, and when we get to that, I'll about roughly 3 years on the inside.
No, I was wondering for the ILA.
They said it took 6 months to come to one with the port, and I said I hope to do it faster than that.
Are our partners needing it done faster than that?
The bank does, well, yes.
That was the question.
Yeah. And what's, they've got all of the property tied up on the waterfront, and but they haven't closed on it. And if they, 6 months, they'll all of their purchase and sale agreements will expire in 6 months. We've got 60 days-ish to get a commitment from the PFD.
For the financial also?
No. We're looking for a commitment from the PFD.
Right.
That they agree that they'll fully fund our project.
Oh, okay.
Somewhat, I mean, I don't know that this is going to be the exact format.
Okay.
But this is our proposal. They have seen attachment B, so are you guys ready to talk about attachment B, or you want to continue to read?
Sure, I'll walk in this way.
Okay. On attachment, and so in attachment B is a document Nick and I have been working on that are the tasks and deliverables. And so task one, they want a, what is this called, Nick? Financial viability study and risk assessment. And so what we had before, tasks one and two were one task. They're asking that one task one be done first to determine the financial viability, and they want to control that process versus the individual project holders. Then we, in task two, we go to design, and each one of these tasks, whoever our public partners are, if it's the port, the county, and the city, which I hope that it is, at each one of these steps, as we get to the tail end of it, we check in with all the partners to make sure, yes, this still makes sense, and we move forward. Task two is actually design and the public outreach. Task three gets to 60% design. Task five gets us to add-ready construction documents, and at this point in time is where we, up to this point, we have a community center, we have a shoreline restoration, and we have a public pier projects that we've gone through the environmental and the permitting. At this point, we break it into three projects because that pier project and the shoreline process will compete very well with specific grant opportunities that are out there through the state. And if we bury them into the community center, they won't compete very well. So the city will take those projects on its own, the shoreline restoration and the pier. And then, so at this point at task five, we're just focusing solely on the community center. Task six, I have some draft language. This will get added onto. I hope you guys will be able to see it by tomorrow night. I'm working with Kitsap Bank on how the PFD, I'm trying to give it in very simple terms, how the PFD could pledge their cash flow. So there's more work to be done here on item number six.
Would we do the bonding if they do their cash flow?
I'm hopeful, it's possible, and I'm trying to keep it very, in the terms that I'm using, it's borrower, because the bank has said that they would be willing to be, because for this project, do a private placement, and that they may even be willing to subsidize the rate as a contribution for their CRA credits.
Right, but it's also, I won't say.
So that's possible. I'm hopeful if we have truly do have three partners. The port has property. They need to be compensated for that property. But also we have time, you know, our staff time, and we're managing a process. Everybody needs to have a contribution to the project, you know, and then I'm hopeful that the county's our partner, and they're the ones that did the bond issuance. Okay, we're not there yet, and that's in step two or three when we get into the weeds of that. First, we got to determine if the thing is financially viable. No sense in getting into the weeds on owner, who's inside of it, and what the leases look like, and who the partners are, until we figure out, determine if it's viable.
Did I hear you correctly in that task one, which is basically the financial say the PFD wanted to be in charge of that particular.
Correct.
Can I state my concern with that?
Okay, and then I'll show you, share theirs, what they told me, why they want it that way.
My concern, I don't care if they do it, that, but I haven't found them to be, time efficient in when they do tasks. So, you know, that's a concern to me, because the way this is gone, that could take them a significant amount of time.
I don't disagree.
I don't disagree either.
Their concern is, and why they want to manage this, is they don't want the outcomes manipulated.
Oh, I can appreciate all that.
And that's why we initially had it, us doing it, and they said, no, no, we want to do this because we want to be, you know, be transparent and in the outcome.
It's the selection of the consultant, not necessarily that report that they're responsible for. They just want to be the one to pick the consultant, because then it'll be an independent selection.
Okay, as long as there's some time parameters on that, then I don't have a problem with that piece of it. I'm just concerned about how quickly they came up.
I believe we've done a better job than other projects pushing the process, but it's still not fast enough for anyone. So, anyway, not more to come on financing if we, you know, hope we get to that stage. And then step seven is actually the actual construction of a $16 to $20 million project. And at that past seven, there's, of the 12 million, there's $9.5 million to be issued. They could issue that in a lump sum, but that's what step six is about, is pledging. You could pledge the equivalent of $9.5 million in cash flow, and that, you know, the partners would look at how we could finance that project. So a lot more to work out, but this is where I'm at to date as of Friday afternoon. And I hope to have more, you know, a paragraph or so in step six by tomorrow evening when I bring this to the full council.
Any discussion on this? The update or?
So I have a question about with the funding of the 12 million, the funding for the feasibility study would be taken
out of the 4 million. Yeah, so each one of these is a bite.
Okay.
So at the end, when it comes to building, it's $9.5 million that's left after we've done feasibilities and design and land acquisition and all of
this. So in order to begin this, to fund this, they need to sign the interlocal.
They won't give us any money until we have a document, these two documents would spell out the obligations on and what the tasks and deliverables are. Yeah, so that's the next. This document, they wanted this document. We wanted to take it a step farther, which was much more detailed than what they were asking for.
Okay. So they weren't just asking for an ILA for the feasibility study. The ILA covers.
That's what they would like.
Okay. But
yes.
This is taking it.
Yeah. We don't want to just fund a feasibility study and put it on a shelf. We want a commitment. If the feasibility study says that this is a good thing to do, we have a commitment to take the next step. And there's check-ins at each one of those steps throughout the process.
So I can jump in. So the feasibility study really helps the city in selling this project to the PFD.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And the PFD, it gives the PFD the comfort that, yes, that the project is
correct.
Does pencil.
So other organizations that are presenting the PFD have economic impact studies that they have already completed, which shows the PFD that if you fund this project, here's the financial return to the community.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so it's nothing different than really if you go into the bank and you sign your line of credit. Well, I'm going to sign off my house and my car and my, you know, my firstborn, and that's how you're going to get your money back. And so as Rob just pointed out, really they want to be comfortable with this project, knowing that it's going to be successful.
Mm-hmm.
Not just give out $9 or $12 million and hope it works. And so, I mean, great job, and that's what needs to really happen. That would really give the city the strength and the stability it needs to sell this product to those guys. And as Beck pointed out, that, I mean, expediency is an issue.
But with signing the entire, the commitment for the entire 12 million, there won't need to be a lag between when the feasibility studies are done and when the project can begin.
What will happen, so there's two different things. There's the community center and then there's the master plan project, okay? And it's a series of dominoes for the master plan project. The indications I've gotten from the bank are if we can get the commitment for the whole project as a whole, they will commit to the master plan project. The developer won't start the master plan project without a commitment from the anchor tenant.
Okay.
And so that's the dominoes out here. I've got to get a commitment from the PFD so that the bank's comfortable, okay, this is going to happen. If there's a $120 million master plan project, I think it really helps the feasibility study for the community center. I think they go hand in hand. We don't have the commitment for the $120 million project. I don't think the feasibility study won't bear fruit. So they go hand in hand.
But I mean, this is much further than what we heard at that at the meeting, where initially they just wanted to give us some money, do the feasibility study, and let it sit on the shelf.
Yes.
This is much more complex.
Yes.
And time sensitive.
And why I continue to push on them, I need a commitment for the whole,
right.
For the whole.
We want the whole platter.
Yeah.
So
that's
the
what
feasibility
I'm asking.
Study, I mean, and Rob's done a great job for pushing that. However the city can get that done, how you facilitate it, I mean, it needs to happen.
Right.
You guys need to be supportive of it. So
yeah.
It only sells your project.
Yep.
So what I'm hearing, are there any more questions about these documents? And what I'm hearing is that it's going to be part of your mayor's report tomorrow evening.
It's actually on the agenda.
It's on the agenda.
It's a discussion item, and I'll have these copies.
Okay, right.
They're in the council packet. Actually, I didn't put them because I didn't make her deadline.
Right.
So it's on there as a discussion item. I'm accountable to the deadlines, so I will pass it out. But I hope to have a more robust section 6. What Kitsap Bank gave me is a whole page long, and it's complicated. And your average person, if you're a banker or a bond issuer, you'd get it. I want it in. I'm trying to show the PFD board and the public, the path and keep it at a high level. It's without confusing.
So if we have any pressing questions, it would be good to get them to the mayor now so that he could incorporate them in the discussion tomorrow night.
Yes, that would be helpful.
Yeah.
What was your last discussion with Kitsap Bank? The reason I'm asking is with their announcement of moving an admin building over to Bremerton, does that change anything with them at all? Okay.
I talked to them a couple of times a week.
I'm just curious because that announcement kind of came. And if you were
well, I think more what's happening in that scenario is they're moving their retail branch out of a building that they're already. They've got three different places they're doing administrative functions, and that's the purpose of this master plan project is to bring all of it under one roof, and they've got a much better opportunity for a retail branch than where they're doing those corporate functions over there in West Bremerton.
Right.
No. I mean, my only request would be, a timeline, and then how can either here or the council help assist.
Yeah. So my goal is to get heads nodding tomorrow night, and we're not voting on it because PFD hasn't approved it yet. Their next meeting is 2 weeks from today. My goal is to get by the end of this week to get these documents to their attorney so that they're on their agenda for 2 weeks from tonight.
Where's that meeting, do you know?
Bremerton.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Bremerton Council Chambers.
Okay.
Yes. So it would be helpful if you wanted to attend that meeting.
That's what I'm saying.
For 2 weeks.
Just even knowing
that's
that
the next PFD.
Yeah.
Yes.
And then just to respond a little bit to what Jack said, this master plan project, if it moves forward, is not going to happen a year from now or 2 years from now. That's a long time. And I think that the bank has some more immediate needs that they
right.
can take
mm-hmm.
care of on a temporary basis.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay. we'll just jump around. Brandy, do you want to do our?
Sure.
We, and we're talking lodging tax, we had a surprise Friday. One of our, one of the folks that you approved told us they just can't, they don't have the time to serve. So where are we at? So then we reached out to a couple of others. So I don't know how we were trying to figure out Friday how we've got to amend the committee.
Right, well, it's in our packet.
Yeah, it's in our packet.
Okay.
So, yeah, we were able to add it to the agenda, the Saints Club. Saints Car Club is who the mayor is recommending, and hopefully the council will confirm that tomorrow night. And then once we get that, then I'll reach out to the chair of that committee and get a date going, so I can share with the other committee members.
And did the Comfort agree to join?
Yes, absolutely. Yep, yep, so we have a committee of four.
Nice job.
So I thought the council approved somebody from POPSA. It doesn't necessarily have, you didn't.
We went through two people there, and they just couldn't do it. They just couldn't do it. They said, they asked not to, for us to find somebody else.
So that's that update. The other date, real update, is that we received 6 LTAC applications, and we're expecting 3 more. The deadline is today at 4 p.m. to get those.
Do you have my 3 on there?
Hmm?
Do you have my 3 on there?
No.
Because I just hit my 3, so.
Probably today, this morning.
This morning, so.
Yeah, that's Friday.
More.
Okay, so, so we have that. Again, it closes today. We'll get that to the committee sometime this week, in the next couple of days, so they can start reviewing it. With that, we will be submitting Footferry lodging tax funds. We got our first invoice, which covers May through end of July, which is about a little over 4,600. Very low ridership, from what I just skimming through the numbers. We haven't done the full calculation. We may be right on our funding. We may be a little over.
Meaning we may have come up with more money.
Yeah, and I think we experienced that a few years ago, and the administration budget was able to cover that difference. I probably won't get the invoice for probably another week or two. Once I do that, I'll bring it back to October ED Tourism to see if I can absorb it within my budget, and our finance department agrees with that process, and it should be under the mayor's administrative authority, so we may not have to come before council. I think it's going to be less than $1,000 for our portion if we are over. I'm suspecting a couple hundred, but so with that in mind, recommending that I'll ask for more funding going for 2020 than we did last year to help offset some of that. We're not quite sure. I mean,
we
reach out as much as we can.
We need a better job marketing it.
Yeah, I mean,
if we're going to do it, and maybe we need some dollars. So how we do that, I don't know. Kitsap Transit, you know, it's a big deal for them to. It's not part of their operation, so they don't build it into their schedule, and they put a banner ad on there, but. That's not where people go look for the service. They go to the Kitsap Transit website and the schedule, and it's not there.
Also, the events downtown need to promote it. Those Sunday events need to promote it, too.
Yeah.
Like the cruise, and I don't know how they do, but.
I think we do pretty good on the big events.
Yeah.
It's the other.
And that's what I'm hoping, that, the Taste of Port Orchard, that Sunday run is going to help offset that cost, but. I mean, it was
fun.
Open zone. So, that's where we're at with that.
Question on that. Have you seen the preliminary budget for that, and has it increased over last year?
I did ask the finance department director, and he did give us the numbers. I did pass it on to the chair of ED or an LTAC. We'll probably have some hearty discussions on that. It's not going to be as positive as I think we were hoping.
Robust.
So.
Surprising.
Well,
it was really good this year.
Well, we also did a biannual budget where it was $100,000 for each one. We have said that we would take a look at where we're at that time frame, bring that back to see if there was an increase in revenues or not. So that would be information we'll share at the first meeting.
With that, that the way that the finance department, they changed the way that they do their reporting. So they went, I believe, I'm not sure exactly, but they went from one reporting system to another. And so what that is doing is when I presented the numbers to the chair, it looks like our allocations for this year is higher than what was allocated. And they're saying that the reason why is because typically when we do a contract for lodging tax funds is they have until the first week in January to submit those funds for the previous year. And what's happening is because they changed the reporting system, it is now January to December. And so all of those January numbers, so the people that, you know, wait until December to in January to turn in those numbers are now part of that year's money. And so what
we went to a cash basis, Jeff.
So what I'm asking for the committee and is if they're supportive of staff changing that lodging tax agreement to where they have to submit their reimbursements by either December 1st or mid-December, so that way the clerk's office and the finance department has time to process that and pay that out before the end of the year. Otherwise, we're never going to have accurate historical numbers without going through some additional accounting processes to extract that out. I think that most people will be able to accommodate that, other than people that hold their events in December. Maybe a little bit of an issue, which would be Jingle Bell Run, and we no longer ask lodging tax funds for chimes and lights. I don't think that that would be an issue. And I don't know that we're going to get lodging tax funding application for Jingle Bell Run this year. I think it's just a change of hands, and I'm not quite sure where we're at with that one. So if that does not come to play, then I think everybody else should be able to submit their events within a certain amount of time. There's going to be Chamber and Visit Kitsap maybe a little bit different, just because they do their monthly, they have some monthly expenses that they have. But we'll have to accommodate that. So I wanted to see if the committee was supportive that I change that date, and if our finance department is supportive of that as well. I don't know, or if it doesn't make a difference, numbers are the numbers, and we'll just subtract out, you know, what it is, or if you want us to say that the reimbursement has to be submitted by a certain time in the same year versus waiting 2 weeks later.
The RCW has some control on that, doesn't it?
It just. It's the award year, so.
Okay, because yeah. I have always felt that for everybody concerned, whether it's the event, or whether it's the city, that there isn't any reason why they can't put those in quarterly. But, you know, at a minimum, or at least semi-annually, but we have organizations that wait and do it, you know, the end of December, first part of January, and it just makes it complicated for everyone. So. Yeah, and I don't know whether we have.
Yeah. So when I'm here, I'll just work with the finance department to see if what their preferences is, see what their timelines are, and then once I get their proposal,
well,
I bring it back.
Well, we've got two of the biggest recipients here. You know, would it be difficult for you to have your paperwork in by December 15th?
Well, like Brandy mentioned, the way that we do it and Visit Kitsap does it for our visitor center operations is we calculate our quarterly expenses and then we just take a small percent of that and submit that. So we can extrapolate the last 2 weeks of the year and submit that, but you know, it's like I won't submit January, February, March, April, May, June, July, August, September. I won't submit third quarter until October 1st or 2nd or 3rd, and so you know, and it's not a problem, but those numbers won't be accurate because then I'll just say, okay, I got 2 weeks left of the year and I got one more payroll period, and if, you know, that represents X percent, throw that all in there. It's just whether or not the finance department will buy made up numbers for 2 weeks. Because, and it's the same way that Visit Kitsap does it also. And we changed that last year. Brandy and I had long discussions on it. I mean, it makes it easier for everybody all the way around when we're not accounting for every post office receipt,
right,
and, you know, things like that. So.
Can't change your cutoff date. Can't change your cutoff date.
For what?
Instead of being January 1, why don't you cut it off 15th of December and run it to the 15th of December the next year?
Because technically I can't submit the last 2 weeks of 2019 in 2020. because you have to spend the money in the year you've been awarded that money. So, I mean.
To spend the money the year it's awarded.
Right.
So they get the information on the 15th, you can write a check December 31st, January 1.
Yeah, they can, but the last 2 weeks of the year would be an estimate on my part.
Because you haven't incurred those expenses yet?
I haven't incurred those expenses yet. See, and so that's where, if I haven't incurred the expenses and I go to the city and ask them to reimburse this for them, in any other circumstance, I'd be denied. Now, if everybody's kosher on that side, then I don't have a problem with it, but.
And that's what I have to work out with.
Yeah.
The other thing that would come to my mind as much as, and I don't know, can't pretend to know how Visit gets that, does it? But if the chamber is awarded X number of dollars for their visitor center, for hours and answering the telephone and postage and all of that sort of stuff, can't you just divide that by 12 and say they get $1,000 a month for doing this?
And that's kind of what we do, but he just has supporting documentation.
And I take a percentage, you know, so 1 month it might be $2,256, and the next month it might be $2,202. You know, I mean, they're always close.
Right.
But, I mean, yes, and that would work also.
It just seems to me that we should be able to, yeah, that there's our housing. Jay, do you have anything?
Nope, just waiting to get the committee good.
Okay.
I do have a question, though. Since the city is the one that puts in for the foot ferry, and at what point is the discussion, does the discussion really take place as to whether or not the foot ferry funding needs to take place? Because it could come to the committee, and then the committee nixes it because the four people on the committee don't think it's necessary.
Then it comes forward to the council.
I know it does come, and the council can kick it back.
Correct.
And stuff like that. But when does the discussion, the whole discussion, take place as to whether or not that funding should even be asked for?
Unfortunately, the budget process, it's usually October.
Right.
Because we don't get the numbers until mid-September.
Right.
By the time we meet with the other partners, it's October, and it's kind of a, I have to put it in here just in case. But usually it's October is when we have that meeting.
So, and the lodging tax committee did, that was a heated topic that we went over. So.
Mm-hmm. That's a very robust discussion.
Yeah, and it's like, I mean, if it's not necessary to put in for all those, then if we just wanted to put in for the holiday weekends or something like that, I don't think it's the lodging tax committee's job to nix everybody.
I would say it's this committee making a recommendation to the council whether the service is relevant or not,
right,
and what days the service should be.
I think that we have a large enough sample size now that we can make reasonable suggestions or recommendations. We have tried many things over the last, let's just say, 10 years, mm-hmm, of the hours that the ferry ran. And if you look at it on a per ridership, it's very, very expensive. But there are some events, and let's just use the Taste of Port Orchard as one, is that that event is bolstered by, mm-hmm, the by the foot ferry and the connection with the Port of Bremerton down there, and same with Harbor Fest.
Yeah, because I'd like to say that the holiday weekends, and you know, and could you build into the request from the city, I didn't, and maybe I should, but giving the cruise lines free ferry passes, because only 50 people are gonna, if we're lucky, 50 people will take advantage of them. You know, build that into one of our budgets, and if I need to go home and write up a third, fourth proposal to say, can we have $300 for free bus or free ferry passes for the cruise lines, just to get them over here?
Right.
I could do that, or you know, can we put that in on the cities that said
the cruise line doesn't? Oh, you mean just for when the cruise ship comes
on
in?
It's Saturday.
No.
Okay. So the cruise? No, cruise is Sunday.
The cruise is. No, I'm talking
cruise boat.
Cruise ship. Oh, the cruise line.
The boat cruise.
Oh, you're talking about the cruise ship.
Right. You know, okay. And using funds for that, just to it'll give everybody a free coupon. I mean, and we've done it, Explore Port Orchard has done it with POPSA, and we've shared the expense, and we've gone over to the hotels over there, and, you know.
I think that needs to be your application, Matt, for the.
Just be careful, obviously. A crew should be, it's not bringing anyone to stay in our hotels here, so that's a big ask. That should be a downtown business association's move.
Heads and beds.
That's how it.
A DBA.
Yeah, right.
But those are all good points that we'll bring up and have discussion.
So I guess I should start here. Should staff continue move forward putting in and lodging tax application funding for 2024?
I think that we should put it in.
Okay.
And then we can look at the numbers, we can always withdraw it.
Okay.
And we need to talk to our partners. We can't say we're not gonna do this without having our partners at the table.
Which are only, we only have one now, it's Bremerton.
Well, partner.
We continue to ask.
Well, the other thing too is we can also take a look at what dates would be more applicable.
Right.
As opposed to all or nothing.
And as we have.
I think that's what we're getting.
As we have that discussion, what you want to remember is when that ferry's going back and forth every Sunday, people rely on it. They know it's going back and forth every Sunday. When you say, okay, now we're only gonna do it 5 Sundays this summer, you're going to lose ridership. Not just, you know, for even the holiday ones.
I'm not sure you will, because I don't believe it's getting used.
On
the other Sundays, I think it gets used regardless on the festivals, because the festivals promote it. That's where we're falling down.
Right.
On those other Sundays, it's not getting used because it's not part of Kitsap Transit's operation.
Right.
And that's where people go to, is the foot ferry, I get asked all the foot ferry ready? Yeah, but I don't see it on the Kitsap Transit website. Well, I know, but there's a flyer down there and they had a banner ad.
And the other piece of that, just your people in the condominiums now and the people in the hotels are a great marketing source. They're, you know, your demographics to get them on that foot ferry to come over. But what is for them to come over for on Sundays? You know, you can get them over on Saturdays. You know,
but the ferry's already running on Saturday. It's the
correct.
Sunday.
Right, it's the
Sunday service, because Kitsap Transit's picked up the holidays.
Right, and someone is not going to drive from Paulsbo to Bremerton to park their car on a Sunday to take the foot ferry over to Port Orchard. Yeah.
And there's no high-speed ferry operation to connect to on Sunday, because
right.
Kitsap Transit isn't
right.
running. So
right.
it's a valid question. Is,
and, right,
is the
and
other service relevant?
And our other, and the funding source we've been using is to put heads in beds. And so you have to get someone across on the foot ferry that's going to stay in a hotel from Seattle or something to.
But I think that whole heads and beds thing is a discussion to have, because nowhere in the RCW does it say this is designed to put heads and beds. Those words don't appear in the RCW. No, it's to attract.
It's in the reporting
it's
aspect,
spending,
but not
no,
on the
it is,
yes.
There is a caveat to that.
But it's not in the RCW. The reporting asks for how many people stayed overnight, how many nights did those people stay. But the RCW says it's to encourage people to come to town to spend money, whether it's buying souvenirs or eating.
Well, regardless, we do have a limited fund, and that is partly why the committee.
There's a reason it's called lodging tax, not retail, attraction tax. The people are spending money in the hotels. It is to attract people to come back or stay in our hotels. Because I'm a taxpayer now.
But if they're staying in a hotel in Bremerton and bring the foot ferry over, then of course, then that doesn't put heads in beds either, so why fund it at all?
So I hear that you're going to have lively discussions
this
year.
We always had a lively discussion last year too. So I'm looking forward to it.
Okay, we'll go on to our plastic bag ordinance. And this is the outreach. I could just ask for a follow-up since we passed. Since we passed the ordinance, the council did, just to make sure we're on top of the outreach, and I understand we're doing this in coordination with the county. So, yeah, do you want to?
Yeah, so we did, the ordinance specifies that we are to coordinate with the county to do outreach to our businesses. We reached out to the county to kind of find out what they had done, and they've certainly hit all of the big retailers in Port Orchard, but I think the question remains, how do we get out to our smaller retailers, and what level of effort do we want to initiate to make sure people are aware of this? And, I think we could probably get a hold of the language that the county used when it sent out their notices, but do you want us to make an effort to mail our businesses based on business license data? Do we want to do more social media type stuff? Do we want to work through our partners? You know, what is the best approach to getting the message out?
What is your date on this?
January 1st.
So, just comment on this, Nick. So, this is prior, Greg Meyer, director. The source, which is your consumer at the cash register, would probably be your first line of communication, your best line of communication. If somehow your partners, the list you've got, you can put a posting at the check stand, put a posting in their facility, because that's your first, that's where the process starts. So probably the least expensive way is that.
Well, the county's currently doing booths inside the store, and they're handing out.
Are they doing it in all the stores?
All of the major stores.
Yeah, Fred Meyer, Safeway, Albertsons, Walmart.
But I see you guys want to staff that, I'm sure.
No, we don't have staff to do that.
Obviously.
So county is doing that on our behalf, because our ordinance goes into effect the same day as theirs.
So I spoke to Chris Piercy, who's doing the outreach for the county last week, and he said, you know, we've got it, we made the commitment that we would do this. And so they have done outreach already, they're continuing to do outreach, both in the unincorporated county and in the cities. So what he was telling me is basically where we kind of need your help is probably coordinating with your chamber and sending a letter out to your local businesses. Just trying to get the word out to the retailers who can pass on the information to the consumers.
Our social media site.
Right.
I mean, to push it on our Facebook, because that's hitting the consumer.
So if you can help us try to reach out to...
Is there too soon to do this?
I don't think
so.
No,
I don't think so.
I think it's every meeting until the end of the year.
But is Chris willing to like go to a chamber luncheon or a POVSA breakfast and, you know, talk to those people?
I haven't asked him for
a presentation.
Yeah.
If
or
nothing else,
I can.
Just a con, you know, in the...
Or we can just bring it up at our meetings too, mm-hmm. Right? Announcement. And we have the county's provided, well, they provide the library with lots of the reusable bags. We've been giving them out like crazy, so.
I mean, I can certainly coordinate with Chris. I can get brochures, I can get bags, I can go. So
right.
I'm happy to do that as well.
Right.
So as a person that stays out of grocery stores nowadays, and does everything I can to stay out of stores, so my question is, Nick, you said the county has it. So have they, in their document, are they doing handouts? What are they doing? Let me know what they're doing.
They have, right now, their outreach is, they've got at the end, you know, when you walk into, you know, where like the guy that peddled the newspapers. He sets up a table, a little kiosk there, and with information. He's got flyers, and they've got a big stack of reusable bags, and they're just engaging with. I mean, you can't miss it. You shouldn't miss it. I mean, I've seen multiple times at Fred Meyer. And matter of fact, I've got multiple reusable bags in my car that I've forgotten. That I get another one, and I stop at the booth and go do my shopping. Eventually, I'll remember that bag.
Yeah, I wonder if we could just have a schedule of when they're going to be, because I haven't seen one at Albertsons, and I go to Albertsons almost every day.
Yeah, I don't shop at Albertsons,
yeah.
But I've seen it at Fred Meyer.
They charge more at Albertsons.
Yeah, they're on my list.
This is his list, though, and was it, you're right. What are their dates?
I mean, they've been, you know, it's showing up in the POI, you know, and stuff. But to be honest with you, until 1 January hits, it's going to be a surprise to some people, and people will go, I got to go back out in my car to get it. But you know, as we get closer, I would say social media banner on the, you know, on the website.
Yeah, that's what I was wondering. If
that's
about
too
soon.
About,
or?
I don't think it's ever too soon.
Yep. But that would be a good idea to coordinate with the stores to have a little sign at the check stands, like, remember January 1st, bring your...
Yeah.
Or on the door.
Yeah.
So on the county's documentation and whatever it is they have, is it safe to put Orchard on it?
In the county's documentation.
Well, I don't know. I mean,
the flyer?
The flyer.
Yeah.
It is.
and Paulsbo and Bremerton, I think.
Yeah,
they're submitting it countywide.
Paulsbo's the only one that's not participating, but yeah. Grand Bayou's already done it. Us, Bremerton, and Kitsap County are part of the county's outreach program. And it's not centric to any government, it's.
What I appreciate the fact of what Axel said and Kathleen echoed is, I would like to see it on cash registers or on doors at the local, you know, so if we can get those from Chris and just.
The business guy wanna put it up.
Well, exactly.
And it may be too soon for them.
It may be.
But yeah, we can continue to push the information out.
And would you want us to do some sort of postcard or notice to our, you know, business licenses? I mean, we can probably go through the list and figure out who's likely handing out bags and who's not, but I think we could probably do some sort of mailer.
Yeah, and is there, can we put something in, you know, the utility bills?
Not an insert.
Okay.
We could, there's a box for text, but nobody's gonna read that. I'm just being honest.
Would you be?
What's my bill?
What's the bottom line?
Yeah.
Unfortunately, more and more people are opting for electronic means.
Just like a.
To do those type of things, which saves us money.
Right, no, exactly. Right.
Whatever the header is, so it can be.
I just wanna make sure that we minimize the people who've never heard of this.
I'd be surprised, cause every, I go to get Carver, I go to Tacoma, I mean, everybody's like, you want a bag? And I'm like, no, darn it, I forgot it. So I have to put it all in my purse or go out to my car, and I mean, we're like, literally, it seems like the last ones that have not implemented this. I've traveled a lot during this past year, and even North Carolina and Florida and New Mexico, I mean, they all have already implemented this. So, I mean, I'm sure there's still a handful of people, like you said, that just aren't aware of it, but.
You gotta give to my brother, you know, and he doesn't have a computer.
Maybe they do all their shopping online now, and that's why they don't have.
The first time they go into the grocery store.
Yeah.
In January, that is.
Okay, so are we comfortable?
Yes.
You're gonna see if we can, either you or Chris or somebody to talk at the chamber, and we'll see about if they're willing to put posters up at their.
And we'll start pushing it through Facebook.
We already have a website, or a webpage on our website that has information and links to state and county resources as well.
Yeah, I think that, yeah, that is on there.
That is.
You know, we did, no longer with the school district. The school district, you know, when you went to their website, said, hey, if you need to, I mean, the last 2 weeks before school started, you had a pop-up thing that said for transportation. So I mean, if you went to our website, possibility.
We'll do the banner. It becomes white noise if we do it now, but as we get to December, you know, it's not just a button on our webpage, but now it's the banner ad.
Yeah, and you're right, I wouldn't do it before December. Same with the chamber.
Okay. Because this came, plastic bag came to this committee, I wanted to make sure we stayed in touch with the follow-through on it. So thank you for joining us this morning, Axel.
Yeah, sorry, it was the last time.
Glad you had a good trip.
Yeah, it was good. It was long.
So, how's it different? I mean, why can't you do these microphones?
This is our little recorder. This captures more than the little recorder that went into the tape machine.
Cause you'll get video. I mean, we don't care, you'll have video. It's fine. Okay.
Yeah, I'd prefer to do this.
You'll get better quality sound and everything, so.
Or.
No, Housing Kitsap is gonna do its next two. We're gonna rotate the board meetings around the county, and so the next two are here.
So now that we're getting towards the end of our discussion, we'll go up to item number one. And that's our community business discussion. Did the Chamber of PAFSA have anything to bring up?
Well.
Oh, we do. I can tell by the way you said that.
Yeah. I need to talk to the mayor about this in private also, but this whole Annapolis stuff. Now I know that supposedly on next month, next week was.
Week from tomorrow.
A week from tomorrow was the unveiling of the information.
Oh, I would reword that.
But that's a work study, so.
Correct.
So.
So we're gonna get a presentation with a timeline and the maps.
Okay.
Okay, and the timeline, the second action, because I've seen the draft version of it, is almost 30 years ago. In 1990, this became, went into our transportation plan and part of our comprehensive plan to build a pathway in our downtown. And we have numerous check-ins with the public from notices. There was a couple hundred notices that went to property owners back in 2010, I mean, I'm shooting from the hip here.
Mm-hmm.
I kind of remember some of those dates.
We've got a timeline of action items and that we're putting into poster boards. We're putting maps together that show impacted properties and what we're actually, I'm not trying to minimize at all what's happening to Whiskey Gulch and the acquisition of the 10 parking stalls that are theirs. But beyond that, the impact is pretty minimal to other property owners.
The other thing that I would just say along the timeline.
And it involves no businesses acquiring parts of buildings. There are the overwater home structures, which is a different subject.
Right, but the Whiskey Gulch property had some ownership changes in 2011, and they pulled building permits in 2011 and did things in 2011. And we had public hearings in 2012, of which they were all noticed for. So none of this is a surprise to anyone.
Shouldn't be.
Should not be. And it's very clearly documented now. What people's memory are may be different than what actually happened.
Mm-hmm.
And again, it's just like we discussed with the plastic bags, and that is, gee, I didn't know, you know, after an extensive amount of outreach had been done. And the other thing that I'm going to say out loud is the city of Port Orchard is not responsible for any leases people have signed. We are not responsible for any hours businesses are open. We are not responsible for their business plan. And we have these conversations frequently in that we had testimony from a downtown merchant concerned that the downtown businesses all have different hours. Well, we're not responsible for that. And we have had conversations with POBSA, and they've contacted their membership, and their membership is not interested in that. But people want to put that at our feet, and that's not where it is. And we've had people talk to us about, again, we'll talk about Annapolis. They're concerned about leases that they've had and their business opportunities. Well, we weren't responsible for them signing those leases, and their building owners were all part of the noticing that we've been doing for the last, you know, 20 years. So, you know, people have to do some due diligence also. And like the mayor, I'm not minimizing this, but when you look at the other businesses other than Whiskey Gulch, none of their parking is being affected. Their buildings are not being affected. So, it's real easy for people without researching it to come to conclusions, which is why, and we have four council members that have not been involved in Bay Street pedestrian path activity. So we're doing a complete pedestrian path 101 for council and for the public. And as you said, it's a work study. It is not a give and take. It is not a discussion time. It's an educational time. So that's what I'm
trying to say. And so that was my question as far as, you know, the disclosure of the information so that everybody, so the rumors can stop.
Right.
And, you know.
I don't know that they have.
I don't know that they will.
No, you're probably right. But, you know, for people, to allow people to make intelligent decisions. And you know, the word transparency is thrown out there so often as the reason for everything. There was no transparency, so, you know, this and that.
And that's what we're gonna show on the 17th, is a very detailed and transparent process that starts 30 years ago.
Okay, good. That's what I, that's why I needed to know, because when, you know, and then, you know, when is, if, when and if there is a discussion about it again. Because I know the public testimony is been pretty frequent. And, you know, the attitude is during public testimony is always, we're here to listen, not to comment. Mm-hmm. And will there ever be a discussion opportunity? And I don't know what that looks like, because I can see somebody standing back there and, you know, everybody trying to defend each other. And
I think the discussions happen one-on-one with people. I mean, the city council deliberates and makes decisions. They gather information, mm-hmm. and make decisions. And interacting with their constituents is a form of communication. So if you've got a concern, that keeps office hours.
That's,
you know,
right.
Reach out to other council members. They've all said that. I mean,
they've got
email addresses. They have voicemails. I don't know if anybody uses their. We even do those anymore? Do we have the voicemails anymore?
We
do,
but nobody
calls them. I mean,
it's one thing to
stand at the podium and do this. It's another thing to have a conversation with the decision maker.
And that's one of the reasons.
And have a meeting. Pick up the phone.
I want to say two things, and the first one is, that's one of the reasons I brought up the transportation thing too, again, is I have a couple of citizens that ask me all the time, what are we doing about the roads in this area? We understand Tremont, but when are you going to get to us? And so I'm trying to, you know, bring that forward, and how can we do that? What was the other point I was going to make? I don't think there, and it was, I know it was really
you know, the tough part too, I'll say that, is one of the things that came up. Okay, I was stalling for you.
Yeah, thank you.
You know, was basically that, you know, we represent the whole city. And what is an issue for one business is not necessarily an issue for three quarters of the people I talk to. So it's a balancing act. Same way we can't repair all the roads at one time. We just don't have the finances for it. And that's the tough part. Mm-hmm. And it is. And I think that this informational meeting is very warranted, very important. I wasn't on the council. And it's important for us, and it's important for the citizens. Okay, back to you.
Well, the other thing, the point I was going to make, and this is my position as a council member, I have read on social media that the council won't meet with them. Well, I do not believe the council should meet with them in groups of two or three, because two or three council members can't do anything. And if we're going to meet with them, and if we're going to have a meeting as you suggested, it has to be full council and an open public meeting that is recorded and that is available on our website, so that we don't have he said, she said, or that. It needs to be, this is the dialogue that took place.
What's challenging that? And that sounds good. Remember, we have a federalized process that has very, very stringent rules to it, that we have a right-of-way agent, and that's what stirred all this up, is we've engaged our right-of-way agent, and they're doing their job, reaching out to property owners to say, we need to acquire this sliver of land. And this project sat because we were working on Tremont, and our next bucket of funding comes in 2022. We built the pocket park down here and segment three, I think it's called, of the pathway, because we had that money this year. The rest of this has been sitting on a shelf waiting for the funding. We knew we got this money.
We got the right-of-way money.
It's on the timeline. There's points and times where we got the right-of-way money, then we got the construction money, and there's only, you know, Mark Garcia only has so many hours in a day. We've got Tremont going on, we've got well projects, the sewer projects going on, and you just have to prioritize your time. We're getting to that project that's been planned for numerous years.
Right, and the construction money was out of Connecting Washington, and I don't think it's available to us till 2022, 2023.
Correct.
Somewhere in that timeframe. So we're doing the right-of-way acquisition now so that we can be ready when the construction dollars are available to us.
Which all of that's in the timeline.
Yeah. And it's, and none of it has been done behind closed doors.
Other than our right-of-way agent
meeting
with individual property owners, which is a real estate transaction between Jack and if I'm the right-of-way agent. And when we come to terms, then we bring that purchase and sale back to the city council and they vote on it as a group.
And federal rules prohibit us from negotiating outside of our right-of-way agent. We can't even have that conversation face-to-face.
Right. So, we can appreciate their concerns because some of the people involved have made investments in their properties and maybe didn't do that with a clear vision of what was anticipated in Annapolis.
Okay. I gotta excuse myself, I gotta go.
Yeah.
Thank you for coming.
Have a great week.
Thanks for coming.
So is there anything else?
I think we both have the police chief coming to our meetings.
Yes.
Who's our speaker?
Let me know how I've got to be someplace else on Thursday. I don't know how it is.
You'll do fine.
Yeah.
And the Bay Street Association has moved to, it's at the Brick House this month.
Okay.
Yeah.
When,
for the next few months.
Next few months, okay.
Yeah. Thursday the 17th or is it the 19th?
7:30, the meeting starts at 19.
19.
Yeah. Have you ever been coming up this month?
On vacation.
When do you get back?
Don't think so.
If there's nothing else, we'll adjourn the video. Thank you.
Mayor, do we have a date on our retreat yet?
No.
But I missed something. It happens every now and then.